In our last episode, we met Second Lieutenant Kenneth Thurstone of the American Expeditionary Force, or AEF, through letters he wrote home to his fiancée, Harriet, while he fought in the last few months of World War I. When we last heard from Kenneth, the conflict in France was intensifying as the Meuse-Argonne offensive entered its final weeks. Today, we'll follow Kenneth's letters through the conclusion of the offensive and the immediate post-war period, and bring a new voice into this story. Elizabeth Fraser, a war correspondent who in early 1919 wrote a detailed account of the offensive in which Kenneth fought.
You must read and have mother and father read in the February 8th Saturday Evening Post the article by Elizabeth Fraser called The Last Fight. It is great and absolutely true as it portrays exactly the truth in what I have seen. Read it carefully, dear.
In our last episode, we heard how Kenneth seemed to downplay the gruesome details of war in his letters to Harriet. Contrasting Kenneth's descriptions of life on the front lines with Elizabeth's, we can see just how much was left out of his letters and how Kenneth's censored firsthand account as a soldier differs from Elizabeth's report as an American journalist.
I am writing this in my little so-called dugout, which I've been living in now for just a week. It has proved itself rainproof and quite comfortable considering the conditions, it being cold and not having any fire. I forgot to tell you, sweetheart, of my dugout mate. He's a little brown field mouse that comes to a box of hardtack that I have and helps himself to it. He sits there now, eating and watching me at the same time. Cute little fellow, but there are millions of them, and they're quite a pest.
While Kenneth focuses on the cute little field mouse keeping him company in his dugout, Elizabeth goes into detail about the true conditions on the front lines.
Now this triple combination of bad roads, shelling, and animal shortage, with the consequent result of tie-ups and jams, had its inevitable repercussion upon the doughboy holding the line. They went forward with no artillery to prepare the way, with no ammunition, sometimes even with no rifles, with nothing but a gas mask filled with hand grenades, with no food for 2 and 3 days at a time, sleeping in the woods in a sodden downpour of rain. The men drank the water from shell holes where dead horses lay. Flies pestered and poisoned them. Dysentery, influenza, pneumonia, and sheer human misery cut down their last reserves of strength. The few who came forth from that hell on missions were gaunt, with bloodshot eyes. Nearly all had a touch of shell shock.
Remembering Kenneth's endorsement of this article, Elizabeth appears to fill in the gaps left by all the things Kenneth couldn't say as he wrote home. Yet, Kenneth continues to put a positive spin on his experiences.
You don't know, darling, what a great relief the old sun is after days and days of living in the rain and mud with no protection but your muddy old dugout and the same old wet clothes. But, dear, I'm feeling fine. No cold and lots of pep. I have all my blankets out in the sun, a bonfire inside my dugout to dry it, and I'm writing this at a little improvised table that is right out in an open valley where we are camped, or rather, dug in.
Did the men, the actual fighters, crouching down in their muddy little foxholes on the farthest advanced front line, know when the word went forth from thousands of headquarters to stop the cannon? Did they realize the significance of the sudden silence that settled down on ridge and valley and plain from Belfort to the sea? Were they glad, those Americans up there? Or had they fought so long and sternly that they had ceased to feel and would only be sensible of a great letting down, a mortal weariness, and a desire to sleep, sleep, sleep?
At last, the armistice to end the war is coming. Kenneth's reactions provide an answer to questions Elizabeth has about how the soldiers reacted to the news.
We understand that the Huns have been given until 11 o'clock tomorrow morning to accept our terms, but to hear the guns early this a.m. and at present, one would not think peace was very near. I can't realize that peace. All that it will bring is so near. That is, I hope so. It is hard for the soldier mind to grasp. It seems sometimes that one would keep on with the fighting forever, and that it was the only work of life, for up here we see nothing natural or the things of peace. It is war. War and all its horrors, and you become so accustomed to it that it seems to be ground right into one.
Elizabeth's predictions of how the soldiers might have reacted turn out to be quite accurate, at least according to Kenneth's account.
Even now, I can't realize this war is over. One reason, I think, is because we know nothing up where we are. It is all so wonderful. I suppose there has been a tremendous lot of celebrating back in the good old USA. In fact, all over the world. Except the soldiers here, right at the front, who have been made tremendously happy, but are really too tired or too something to really have a bang-up celebration. Of course, darling, fini la guerre does not mean that work has stopped or that we are all sitting around smoking peace pipes. Far from it.
Though the war has ended, the American military still has work to do in Europe.
Nevertheless, though none spoke of it openly, everybody knew that, so far at least as the American army of occupation was concerned, it would be like the classical two-faced Roman god, Janus. One face stern, just, vigilant, turned toward the Rhine to guard the nation's rights. The other face turned forever wistfully toward America and the waiting hearth fires there.
With the combat finished, the idea of going home is a more immediate reality for soldiers like Kenneth, for whom the end is finally in sight.
Anyways, darling, I pray that, now that I have been spared from death by the enemy, the good Lord will bring me home to you safe and in as good health as I am at the present. It may be a good many months, but there is one end in view, and that is you and I and our future. Gosh, how great I feel. If only you were right near me this minute for me to hold and kiss you, you dear girl.
Despite the hope that the armistice has brought men like Kenneth, doubts about the peace linger in the aftermath of the war. Elizabeth quotes a French civilian who can't trust that the war has ended after years of conflict.
But do you believe it's true? That it's really finished, the war? Don't you think it's just a ruse? That they have something up their sleeves and are just playing for time, and presently it will break out again? All the horrors recommence? I do. I'd like to believe it. What joy. But I can't. She had been steeped so long in a world of horror that her soul was incredulous of a world of peace.
Once he's stationed in Germany, Kenneth picks up on political tensions within the country that prompt him to doubt the peace process as well.
From what I can get out of these people, they still seem to remember the Kaiser, but they lay all the war on the Crown Prince. That one thing makes me think that maybe peace is not so very near after all. But I see no newspapers, so know nothing of what is really going on the outside.
Though Kenneth reports no deeper knowledge of Germany's post-war situation, perhaps the tensions he's picked up on are related to the German Revolution that would replace the country's monarchy with the democratic government of the Weimar Republic. Unfortunately, these doubts have ominous foresight. Unbeknownst to Elizabeth, Kenneth, and the world at this point, the outbreak of World War II is only 20 years away. And amidst the hopes and fears of the post-war period, Kenneth and others grapple with another emotion, grief.
I had one of your letters, dear, the other day, in which you spoke of Al. It was the first I heard, and of course grieved me greatly. I shall never forget our friendship and the good times we had together as kids. I'll drop a line to his people at once.
Kenneth's not the only soldier grieving the loss of a close friend. Elizabeth writes of another man whose friend was killed in combat.
On that morning of the 11th of November, Corporal Dudley was not in the best of moods. He was, in truth, about the bluest young man upon the whole of that advanced skirmish line, for his buddy had just been killed. When he got a few minutes off, he intended to scribble a word or two to his buddy's father. It was strange how he instinctively shrank from that simple task, but it was like burying his friend afresh.
Eventually, Kenneth learns more about the fate of his childhood friend.
I also heard about Al. Talked with a chaplain that had seen his grave. Much to my surprise, I found that the day Al was killed, I was within a very short distance of the place. In fact, went through the village where he's buried. The chaplain told me that the grave was very nicely arranged and had been fixed up by some engineers. He's buried in a little plot with 6 enlisted men. It all seems so strange that he's gone. As much of death as I have seen, it is hard to picture those of yours.
Soldiers who died in battle were buried there, far from home. But Elizabeth at least finds comfort in knowing that many of these soldiers were buried together.
I do not know why a solitary American grave, seen in these scarcely cold battlefields, should smite the heart with such a sense of sadness and desolation. But so it is. With the groups of graves, the feeling is quite different. There, one has a sense of ease, even of warmth and cheer. They lie so close together, those buddies in their eternal billets. One feels that if they become restless or lonely through the long vigils, they can turn over and pass the time of day with their comrades.
The human cost of victory in World War I was profound, a point on which Elizabeth and Kenneth agree.
Someday, perhaps, a genius, with a pen dipped in flame, will write the epic of those grim weeks in the Argonne, those dreadful nightmare days and nights of struggle, where officers went mad from strain, where men and brutes dropped in their tracks from fatigue, where the forest and even the implacable elements themselves seemed leagued with the foe. That any advance whatever was made seemed a marvel. But the numerous groups of graves scattered about by dozens and by scores, and a good-sized cemetery, its thicket of rough-whittled little crosses seen remotely against the skyline on top of a particularly high, bald ridge, were mute reminders of the atrocious price paid.
Kenneth, in plainer terms, rejects the idea that this loss of life was meaningless.
I see by the papers that some are beginning to criticize the loss of life in the Argonne. Those men did not die in vain. If there had not been that great loss, we would be fighting now. How much worse that would be. Uncle Sam was fighting the hardest fight of the war in there, and of course our men paid the price of victory. The Americans won the war, and they won it in the Argonne along the Meuse.
Understandably, after so much loss and destruction, Kenneth and Elizabeth share a strong negative sentiment against Germany and the German soldiers as America's enemy in a long and brutal war. Just prior to the armistice, Kenneth writes,
"But I don't want peace unless Germany is completely beaten in every sense of the word. I know that her soldiers are, and if peace don't come now, it will only be a matter of time before we drive her back on her own soil and destroy her own cities, towns, everything, in fact, as she has been doing to that part of France and Belgium overrun by her."
Elizabeth includes an anecdote of an American soldier first learning about the peace by witnessing German soldiers' celebration.
"He beheld an astounding sight, for he saw Huns swarming like ants from an anthill and running excitedly about. He saw them hurl away their rifles. He saw them join hands and dance a jig and fling their arms about. Were they stark mad? For 10-20 seconds, in tense, frowning absorption, Corporal Dudley watched these grotesque figures capering like lunatics, silhouetted afar against the lowering sky. Then he stood back from the tree and drew a big breath. the truth made a hesitating entry into his brain. Was it peace?
Though conveyed in pejorative, biased language, perhaps influenced by Elizabeth's position as an American war correspondent, this anecdote slightly humanizes the German soldiers who celebrate the end of the war despite having fought for the losing side. Kenneth's post-armistice letters, however, drop the harsh language, particularly once he's stationed in Germany and interacting more with the German people beyond the context of the battlefield.
The German girl that lives here just brought me a dish of apples. My gosh, how good they taste. We can't pay them or ask for them, but we can eat them, and that's what really counts. It really takes some effort to act distant to them.
Kenneth even reports listening to war stories from a former German soldier, a young man of his age, whose family Kenneth is living with at Christmas time, a change from his earlier, harsher perspective.
The young German who lives here, about 22, has just been showing me some pictures from Macedonia. He was in the German army there, opposite Salonika. He had been home now about 3 weeks.
Perhaps Kenneth's shifting depictions of the German people as the American military shifts from combat to occupation of German lands are just another aspect of the complexities and contrasts inherent in war, something both he and Elizabeth acknowledge in their own ways.
Hell and glory, that is its portion. Only, as one of its captains dryly remarked, the men get the hell and the world gets the glory.
World War I was certainly hell for the men who fought in it. Yet, as in other letters, Kenneth readily acknowledges the spectrum of things he's witnessed overseas, from the wonderful to the terrible.
The nights up here are wonderfully picturesque, and my mind is full of pictures that I'll never forget. And dearest, I'll bring them back to you and try my bestest to make you see them as I have. Of course, other sights I'll have you try and make me forget, because war is full of them and a place of contrast. I feel as though, if only I could paint or sketch, what a great thing it would be. For no photos can ever show the light effects I have seen, from bursting shells or the setting sun.